And I have some t-shirts. So early on, the Shmoo Group hosted a TF2 tournament at DEF CON. It has become known as Hack Fortress. And a Shmoocon shirt from last year, or 2 years ago. All right, with that, I'm sure you'd probably like me to stop talking, and so you could start hearing this talk. So please give a warm Shmoocon welcome to Brian, who will be talking about server time fingerprinting.
All right, can you hear me? Can you hear me? How's that? Cool. Everyone having a good con? I know I am. I am super pumped to be here. Thank you for coming. So my name is Brian Cardinale. Long time lurker. I've been coming to con for a number of years. This is my first time speaking at a conference ever. So thank you for being here with me for this tremendous moment. Please be gentle. So I'm a maker, breaker of things, mostly software, do development stuff, and currently doing pen testing stuff. It's good to know how to build something to break it, or how something works to break it. I'm a father and future husband. My fiance and daughter are in the front row here to support me. Thank you, guys. I am a cartoon lover. You might see that as we go through the slides. I have approximate knowledge of many things, as any good pen tester should. And I'm a New Jerseyan, you know, New Jersey represent. Woo! Yes! So, precursor to this talk, Mike?
One on your right here?
Yeah. Thank you. Oh, that's way better. Okay, so assumptions are, you've seen a web request before. This isn't mandatory, but it'll help as we go through this. An idea of what a session identifier is, or why we need to maintain sessions with web applications, or any application in general. The concept of cross-site request forgery, where we're sending transactions that a user didn't intend to do, which we use, and hashing. And we're going to go through all of this, but if this picture on the right-hand side here looks familiar to you, then you're in a good place. And if not, you're going to learn a couple things along the way. So for today's agenda, this talk's overarching theme is weak tokens hiding in plain sight. So we're going to talk about how to identify them, reversing them, and that's caveated with attempting to reverse them. This is not a perfect science. Mileage will vary greatly, and lots of pain will be had if you don't know when to cut your losses. And then finally, we'll talk about strategies, how to prevent this from happening in your applications, and how you can tell people how to secure their applications better. So some background. We have a bunch of different people, and they have a bunch of different ideas. The software development team and users want applications to scale and do it fairly securely. Apps are there to serve and protect our users and our data, and attackers want to burn stuff. And I like burning things. So users and the software development team are like, give us 24/7 uptime, because I don't know what scaling is. I just want to be able to access my data whenever. And the software development team says, do it securely. And apps are like, we're trying our best. And attackers are like, you're doing great. Just stay the way you are. So apps need to protect and serve. Among other things, they need to be able to identify individual users. They need to protect against fraudulent requests, so making sure that bank transfer was initiated by a user who was intending to initiate it. And avoid things like object enumeration. So when you have things where ID equals 1, well, what does ID equal 2 get me? And things like that. A number of these protections are provided by tokens or nonces. The terminology actually is very fluid. It actually gets kind of hairy when we get into it. So I went back and forth with a couple terms, but the two that I landed on were stateful tokens and stateless tokens. So a stateful token, a string of data, will reference other data. It doesn't carry any data in and of itself. A stateless token contains data. There's information to be had from that. So an example of a stateful token is a raffle ticket. You have one, and the person drawing the contest has the other. And by the fact that you have the same number, he knows that you belong to that ticket. A stateless token is like your ID. It contains information about you. The validity of it comes through either an RFID chip or that it's very difficult to make that ID, but the ID itself has data. So we throw around words, tokens, identifiers. I go back and forth. Gets very confusing. Nonces. Wow. Can't say that word. Excuse me. Nonces, which are numbers used once. But in the context that we're using them, we actually use them for a while. And how long is a while? Well, a while is relative. So maybe we propose a new term. Numbers used for a relative while might should be narwhiles. I don't know. Yeah. So, narwhiles. Let's see a web request with some narwhiles. So a tale of two servers. So with traditional web apps or any application, when you want to fetch data from the server, user's going to send a request, and the request is going to come along with it a chunk of data, going to be your identifier. And when that user passes that data to the web app's going to say, okay, let me check that. And then he has to go back to some type of data store. And in our case, our data store is Mr. Database Hat. And the web app is going to say, do you know this guy? He gave me this ticket. And he's like, let me check. And then the web app tells the user he's checking, but really the user just sees a loading bar. Then database gets back and says, yes, we know him. Awesome. The web app says, can I have their data? And he says, sure, here you go, and here you go. So in that scenario, the web app couldn't verify the user by itself. He had to go reference a data store. So this comes into play when we're trying to scale apps and trying to make apps stateless. That becomes a problem because you're creating a single bottleneck. So that same scenario, when we pass an identifier that contains its own data, hopefully securely, goes something like this. So on the left-hand side, a user has a chunk of data that actually has meaningful data in it that identifies that user. Now, that data could be faked, for lack of a word, word escapes me. So we want to have some type of way of verifying that that data was not faked and that it's been signed. So one of the ways that we do that is by signing it. So the user has a piece of data. Another authority that the web app trusts has signed that data cryptographically or by other means. And the web app contains the token, or contains the keys, or a way to verify that that signature is accurate. So it doesn't need to reference a data store. So when the user passes a chunk of data that contains identifiable information of him, they verify, okay, this looks authentic, and then just hands back the data. So there's no need to go back to a centralized data store. This works really well when we're trying to scale applications. So both of these, stateful and stateless tokens, need to have two characteristics. They need to be unpredictable and unique. They need to be unpredictable so we can't fake them. So an attacker can't just change this stateful, stateless token that has user data and say, I'm user data John Smith. So we need to add something that makes it unpredictable. And in the case of tokens, signing it cryptographically is a good way of doing that. We also need to make things unique. So it gets tricky when you have stateless apps that are serving same users, they're generating IDs. How do you guarantee that those two servers are not generating the same ID? Because you're going to cause a collision and might assign it to two different users. This creates a problem. So we've kind of talked about this already. Stateful tokens require central validation. Stateless tokens have distributed validation, so stateless tokens scale a little better. The stateful token should not contain any meaning other than itself, and stateless tokens contain meaningful data and claims. So the problem happens when the differences between these two type of things starts blurring, and to create a raffle ticket, developers start using data that has meaning to create that ticket. And to a human eye, it doesn't look like much. So which one of these is more secure? If I'm looking at a web app and I see that top string, I'm like, cool, that's gonna be pretty cool. I'm gonna poke the crap out of that. But the bottom one, I'm like, oh, that's a big blob of data. That's just a session ID, whatever. You know, I trust that J session ID, they took the due diligence and implemented that correctly. So I might ignore that. But they're actually the same data, just being hidden. So that top data and the bottom data are actually the same thing. If we look at the code behind, that hash or that string of data is being generated by, let me see if I have a mouse. Nope, no mouse. So the top line where it says session data equals secret data, pipe data, whatever, we append, or the developer appends, system.currentTime in milliseconds. This is a very common practice for developers. I am very guilty of this in the past. Forgive me for my sins, but this is very common. And what happens is you do that, and then you hash it. And when you hash it, it's basically putting up makeup on the token. So that token is crap. But once we hash it, it makes it very difficult to the human eye to say, no, that's not a good token. So predictable data tends to be predictable. So we need to add entropy. And that's what adding those milliseconds is, adding entropy. But time is a bad source of entropy. Time is predictable. Time plus data, bad nonce. Time plus data obfuscate, bad nonce with makeup on. What we're seeing is, this is a term called key stretching. We do this all the time. You take a password, you don't store your passwords in clear text and database, I hope you don't. If you do, don't do that. So key stretching, basically we're taking a form of weak data, we're putting it through some type of algorithm, it's generating a longer string, and it's making that data more secure. It's either generating the string longer, or it's actually, it can also be time-wise. So we give it an algorithm and generates a long string, and it takes 100 milliseconds to do that. And that makes it prohibitive for an attacker to keep guessing all the iterations of it. So with key stretching, we get this in an output of what's called an enhanced key. We get a long chunk of data from a short piece of arbitrary data that might be predictable. To brute force the enhanced key should be impractical. So to brute force the key space of even 128 bits or 32 character MD5 hash is not practical. Should have the numbers up here, but it won't happen in our lifetime. I don't even know if we have the energy. Unless the algorithm is broken. In case MD5, it is broken, we can create collisions. But what is practical, or could be practical, is brute forcing the initial key. So trying to reverse that chunk of data and determining what the developer put behind to create that key. So is it possible? How do we do this? So is it possible with the same value twice? So what we're going to do is we're going to send a bunch of requests and see if we can get the same token twice. Because if we can get the same token twice, that can tell us something. If we try to get the same token twice and we don't, cut your losses. This doesn't actually mean that it's not predictable. It's just, it's not going to be as straight. This is a difficult problem. So if you don't have access to the code and you don't know what the algorithm is, it's going to be problematic. So how do we do this? First, we need to find where we're using these numbers. And they're everywhere. They're session IDs, CSERF tokens, encrypted data, object identifiers. If you see the source of a web page or the request going back and forth, you can identify where these data's where these numbers exist. Down here is an example of set cookie, session ID equals, and then a blob of data. What we want to do is we want to ask for a lot of them, and then we're going to ask for a lot more. So we want to gather as many of those as possible. And while we're doing that, we want to do that while using threads. And the concept is web servers by themselves are multi-threaded. A web server that wasn't multi-threaded would be a bad web server. It can only serve one user at a time. That's not a good design. So what we're hoping is we can make our threads request that time data at the same time. Even if it's down to the milliseconds, we can get that to return the same millisecond value. That will give us the inferment that this data is coupled with time-based data. So a couple ways of doing this. The way I prefer to do it, one of the ways of doing it is to use a tool like Burp Suite. Let's see. So force collision. So what we're seeing here is a website. We're logging in. This website's already terrible because the password's not shielded. User logged in. And when we logged in, we did this through an intercepting proxy. So we were able to capture the request, so you can see that this is the web request that we sent Bobby and password 1234. And then in the response, the web server responded and said, okay, here's your token, here's your identifier, so when you come back to me and ask for more data, I know who you are. So we got a unique value. And basically what I want to do is, okay, can I have 20,000 more of those? And let's see. So within Burp Suite, there's a couple of different things. Repeater, this I wanted to show that there's some time delay between sending a request and getting it back. So this is actually fairly fast. 27 milliseconds in a web app, fairly fast response. You can get 200 milliseconds, et cetera, and that's going to play a role in trying to determine whether or not this data is time-based. We want to get as close to the server as possible, and there's techniques of doing that. So I'm going to send this request from Repeater, which is just demonstrating that it takes time to send a request. This intruder portion of Burp Suite, what it does is allows us to send craft requests and send them very quickly, and we can send them via thread. So you can do this with Burp, you can do this with a shell script, you can do this with a number of things. Hopefully this will be built into a tool that you'll see later as well. So inside intruder, what I'm doing here is I'm highlighting the user agent string because I don't really want to modify any data. I just want to send this over and over again. So one of the hacky ways I do that is using the user agent string, and I'm just going to increment that value arbitrarily. It means absolutely nothing to the web server. It's just a hacky way of getting intruder to do this, if anyone's ever used intruder. And using this, we're just going to send a bunch of requests. So I'm literally just going to send the numbers, I think, 1 to 1,000 or 1 to 100, just so that we can get more and more of those tokens. And hurry up. You take forever. Oh, and one of the things that we're doing while we're doing this is I want to pull back the identifier to be able to actually see that data and do some comparisons on it. So in part of this tool, you can select a chunk of data that you want extracted, and it'll come up in the results, and you'll see that in just a second. So we're going to kick off an attack here. It's going to send a ton of requests. And we look at the session identifier. To the human eye, that might look like there's nothing there. But within 8 and 9, we got a collision. We got two of the same tokens. After 9 requests, that's actually terrible. So this is that is terrible. And then I went further down the list, and there actually is another collision. But you'll see that that's not, like, from a developer's perspective, if there's not too many users on the system, this works fine. Every user gets it. It's like only if two users at the same time request the same thing, they might, something weird might happen. Someone's going to log a ticket. They're not going to know what happens. They're not reproducible and move on with their lives. So this is important. And there's the other collision there. So that's basically that's the basic of the premise, just to like put a bullet note into that. To find data that might be influenced by time, we want to send multiple requests on multiple threads in the hopes that we're going to ask for time on two separate threads and get that data back. So once we have that, we have a control scenario. We know how many requests we need to send, how many threads we need to send to the web server, and another important thing is what IP address or what source network did we send the data from? Because another thing that developers do, and I've seen this, is we'll use the IP address of where you're coming from coupled with time to generate your identifier. So as we're going through this, we'll see ways of identifying other variables that go into this, and coming from a different source network at the same time is one of those scenarios. So this token sucks. Now what? We have two options. So for sane people, we can just document this and move on. We found a problem, tell the developers, tell them to fix it. They fix it, try it again. For masochists, or people like to say, look what I can do, we can try to reverse this data and either take over other user sessions, get access to data that we weren't supposed to. Whatever that token was protecting, we are going to try to burn it because we like to burn stuff. So I'm going to take a minute to take a drink. Why is this for masochists? There's not a trivial problem, and we need to know more and more at the app. There's a lot of ways to represent time, and different languages will represent epoch in different ways. And I've learned this the hard way by trying to do this. So Java will give you an epoch string that has no decimal points with milliseconds. PHP will use a decimal point. If you hash a value that doesn't have a decimal point to a value that does, you're going to get two separate hashes. So keep that in mind. We need to know the format of time that a developer might use. And we can think like a developer. Like, they're writing in Java. If I was writing in Java, what would I use to grab that data? So after we figured out that we have predictable data, one of the things we need to do is determine the token format. And the reason we need to do this is because we need to determine if and how we can reproduce it. So there's good candidates and bad candidates for this type of attack. The good candidates are ones that we can reproduce easily. So that's candidates that have known algorithms, such as hashing algorithms. So MD5, SHA-1, SHA-256, SHA whatever. Or another type is UUIDs, unique IDs, or GUIDs. I call them GUIDs because I started at .NET and they call them GUIDs. And then there's other candidates, ciphers or custom or HMAC. So cipher and HMAC require a key, and we're not going to necessarily know that key. For ciphers, there's attacks like padding oracle attack and things like that. It's better to do more cryptanalysis on ciphers than trying to do this type of attack first, just because we have missing elements. So we're looking for good candidates, things that are using UUIDs or hashes. So hashes, you're probably mostly familiar with hashes. MD5 and SHA-1 both have set sizes, so 128 bits, 160 bits. SHA-2 and SHA-3 have variable sizes, so you can have anything like 224 to 512. And these are usually represented in ASCII hex. I say usually because developers are wily, and they can do whatever the hell they want, really. And for hashes, they're usually non-iterative. And let's take a look. So back to our crappy source data of secret data and then time. If we hash that with MD5, it looks like that. It's 32 characters long. That's what MD5 represented in ASCII hex looks like. If we do SHA-1, it's 40 characters. But it's the same data. So different numbers, same data. And of course, if we hash that same data, we can get another string that's 32 characters. And if we do SHA-1, we can get one that's actually shorter. That's 29 characters. So everyone knows that, right? Why does this happen? So if it's the same data and we're hashing it, why is it different? So developers deal with bytes. We get used to our conventions of MD5 looks like this ASCII hex string. But developers have to deal with bytes. And they don't really care what it looks like as long as it does its job. So they can take that byte digest and make it anything they want. They could dump it as a base64 string or whatever. So on the left-hand side, we have convention, where we hash something, we have a 128-bit data blob, and then we convert it using ASCII hex because we're sane, and it looks like that, and everyone's in agreement. That's an MD5 hash. On the right-hand side, I'll do what I want. They take the output, and then they base64 encode it, and they're like, ah, crap, those equal signs are going to totally screw up this request. I'll just base64 encode it again. Like, the cell's my problem. I've seen this. So that's how you get an MD5 that looks like it's 32 characters, whatever. So numbers aren't always what they seem. So based on that information that we just went over, can anyone tell me what this number is? I'll give hints. Say it louder. No? No. Cool. Good guess, though. So more information. It's 32 alphanumeric characters. Any guesses? Anyone wants to play the game? MD5. So this looks like an MD5 hash. I thought it was an MD5 hash. This is not an MD5 hash. That will drive you nuts. So what started, this looked like an MD5 hash. I was convinced it was an MD5 hash. When I started going down that path of requesting more and more, I identified that the first part of it changed, but the last part of it didn't. So hashes are not iterative. So there's something else screwy going on here. So if I add dashes, does anyone know what that is? Yes! Son of a bitch! So this is RFC 4122 UUID. This is a standard universal identifier. It has a format. There's significance to this red number. Does anyone know what the significance of that number is? What's that? It says not four. Yes, not four. That says one. Four is better, not great. But that number carries the type of UUID. So there's a couple of different types, and there's a couple of different variants as well, but I don't want to get too far into the weeds. But the various types are implemented differently. And type one is straight up date, time, and MAC address. This This is awesome. So if the server has two NICs, you'll see it issue UUIDs that have the MAC addresses of both. So that could throw you off too. It looks like two different numbers, but they just go back and forth. The left-hand side is literally the date value. But it's not the date value like epoch time, because that would be easy. It's the number of 100 nanoseconds since 1520, like based off the Gregorian calendar. But anyway, it's a time-based value. And the other ones here are also predictable, but the ones you see most are version 1 and version 4. Version 4 is actually random, but that's implementation dependent. So they could be using a random that's a time-based source. So more obfuscated, but still same problem. And why are we even here? So if you look at the standard for RFC, do not assume that UUIDs are hard to guess. And the only thing here is at the bottom, it says kind of the premise of this talk. Humans do not have the ability to easily check the integrity of a UUID by simply glancing at it. So these numbers, unless you see a bunch of them together, look okay. But once they get into a group, you know that, you know, you might want to cross the street. If you see a group of those together, they're bad. So to my knowledge that I know of, and I'm sure there's more of them, there's databases that use UUIDs as primary key, and the one they use is time-based. So developers that don't want to have object enumeration might use the UUID thinking that someone's not going to be able to guess the next thing. But if you look at these two numbers generated 2 seconds apart, the right-hand chunk of it is exactly the same. It's the left-hand side that's changing ever so slightly. Went too far. So in this scenario of this demo, there's a company site that stores their press releases on the server. And developer was super clever, and he's like, we can't publish them until they're ready, so how am I going to do that? I'm going to use time-based UUIDs, and I'll just check, is it past that time or not? So that's the premise. Oh, I got to escape. How are we doing on time? We're doing pretty good on time. So this is Bad Time Company website. They have press release websites. They have two press releases, one from January 9th and January 12th. It's a Latin-based company. You'll see when I click on these links, it's going to the same place, but it's just sending this different weird number. And again, from a human, like even those numbers were very similar, but because we didn't even see them next to each other, you might not pick up that they were very close. So there's a tool that I've been building to try to make this easier. I have the GitHub link at the end of the presentation. Call for help, because things got hairy. Come help me. A number of things that this does is it'll decode that value. So it'll take that value and print out the timestamp so you can get an idea of what the information is there. And what I'm demonstrating here is I'm grabbing this ID, I'm taking it over to the tool and decoding it, and there's a correlation between that timestamp or that file, that identifier. Sorry, I should drink. Drink! Water. There's a correlation to that identifier and then the date of the press release. So the identifier says it's January 12th. That UUID translates to Thursday, January 12th at 10 a.m. So these guys published this around 10 a.m., you could assume. The end here where it says not implemented is where I'm going to dump the MAC address. It was irrelevant for the talk, so I just move on. That will be there. And hopefully it drags us down. So January 12th, the press release was released on January 12th. So Bad Time happens to be a publicly traded company. And their stock price can fluctuate. So what could be interesting from an attacker standpoint is if they release a press release that may influence their stock price, either up or down, I can bet on that and either put puts on them if they're going to do poorly, or whatever, I can try to gamble this. If I can get that press release before everyone else, then I might be able to win. And because they're not released, they're waiting to release it to the public. We want to get it before they release it to the public. So what we can do is try to generate our own UIDs moving forward. So because they're time-based, and we know there's kind of a correlation between when they release them and the UUID, we can just generate all the UUIDs for January 17th or January 16th. I forget what day it is. So that's what the tool is doing here. So this is not trivial. I think it's 8.6 million. Let's go with that. 8.6 million of these in a day, I think. There might be more. That's for a whole day. If we can narrow our time window down to, like, say, 9 to 5, that gets smaller. Or we can narrow our time window down by 10-minute increments. So we can small that. 8.6 million is not a large number when it comes to creating guessing values. So that's what the game plan here is, to generate all the values moving forward to try to guess if we can see if there's press releases forward. The tool up here, generate the values, and what I'm doing here is just tailing the output. So we you notice that most of it's static, and on the left-hand side, they're incrementing upwards. We generated from 10 a.m. to, I don't know what it generated. Demo fail. This was, sorry, recorded these last night with some drinking involved. We generate a list of UUID, basically test candidates, and we're going to take that request that retrieves that file, and we are going to use Intruder, just because I'm familiar with it. We're going to select that value as our insertion point, and we're just going to try each one of those values. And we're going to hope that we can get back a file that maybe wasn't released yet. So in this case, we're using 100,000. Realistic, you'd probably be using millions. But let's see. What we're waiting for, cool. So what we're waiting for is, I just sorted that by the status. So when the first one is the base request, we got back the initial press release because it was a valid request, the one they gave us. The rest of them were errors because we were requesting a non-existent file. They were supposed to be 404s, but for whatever reason, the web server decided to throw errors. But you'll notice that at request 503, there's another 200. So if we go check out what data we got back, render it. So press release not released yet, January 16th, tomorrow. We will no longer be selling clocks as of January 16th, 2017. That is, will crush this company, clock company. So anyway, terrible premise, whatever. But you get the idea. So, and if an attacker can grab the press release the day before and put puts against the company, they could possibly, get monetary value out of this. This actually happened. There was a talk back in Black Hat saying, get rich or die trying the Black Hat way, where, I don't know if it was this exact scenario, but they were able to predict the press releases and made a grand amount of money. They thought it was insider trading, but they're not inside the company. And they were from a different country, so they got away with it. All right, moving on. So it's not always going to be that easy. That was fairly straightforward. It's a number. It represents a date. It looks like it's unique, but it's not. Not always a problem. Needed to figure out what's being used for. Type 4 was mentioned. Type 4 is random. The standard says don't use UIDs when the mere possession of them grants you access to something. The type 4 being random, I would check the implementation to see if it's actually a cryptographically secure random. It might not be. It might just be random, which is going to be likely a time-based value in of itself. So I would generally advise to avoid UUIDs for this type of purpose. So other types that we might run into. So we looked at hashes, and we looked at UUIDs. The other type that we might run into is ciphertext. So ciphertext generally need to be broken to begin with. If you're familiar with ciphers, and this is kind of going off the beaten path, so I didn't dive too far into this, but if you have a ciphertext and it's using a static IV, when you keep encrypting it, when you modify data, it will show where in that data it was modified. So having a static initialization vector will reveal your hand. This is really good at figuring out what data elements go into it, but still, we might not be able to reverse the actual cipher because we don't have the key. So these are poor candidates. There's other ways of going about this, such as padding oracle attacks and other cryptanalysis. But I highlight them just we're identifying them. So we need to identify that this probably is not a good avenue to go down. And then the other kind would be custom. So developers just implement it wherever the hell they want, and it generates a string of data, and we don't know how it was created. So not knowing the algorithm is going to prevent us from creating a test tokens quickly. If we can find another avenue and get the application to drop its code through either stack traces or things like that, we might be able to start reversing what the algorithm is, but that requires another type of attack. So if we identify a good candidate, UID, or hash value, we can try to generate and submit our own test tokens. So start simple. keep it stupid simple. We're going to start with what we know. So we know that there's likely a time value involved. We don't know exactly what format it is, but we can do some inference. So if it's Java, we know how Java produces epoch time with and without milliseconds. If it's UID, we just saw that whole demonstration. We can also guess potential data delimiters. Thinking like a developer, if I'm concatenating data, I might pipe it, or I might put commas between it. So that's also another avenue that might happen. Other known values. So this premise comes from an identifier which should be meaningless besides its ID carrying useful data. So a developer might want it to carry the user ID or the role ID. This is usually information that we could figure out by just interacting with the server what our data is, and if we that becomes useful. So we want to generate all the formats for each potential element and generate a wide range, and we're using time leaks as a starting point. Let's see. Yeah. So we want to guess at the format, and we want to guess the time, and hopefully the premise of this talk, or the name of this talk, excuse me, server, do you have the time? Can we get the server to tell us epoch time? And in most cases, you can, because developers also use that to break caching. And we'll see an example of that in this video. So going back to our login requests, when we submit the user, this was the response. And inside the response, they included a reference to a JavaScript file. And the problem that we run into is, development team is not the server admin team. So if there's a file that's being cached, like JavaScript gets cached because we don't want to keep sending all this data. But the developer's like, we change that JavaScript file all the time. So to prevent caching, what they'll do is they'll put a unique value in just a random get variable, so the server needs to fetch it. And a lot of times, that's epoch time. So this is the epoch time on the server. Why is this important? Everyone has the same time. It's, might be a different hour, might be a different time zone, but everyone has the same time. Servers might not have the right time set. If the time's not critical to the application, who cares? It could be 1970, but if it's not breaking the application, who cares? So knowing the epoch time of the server makes this a bit more viable because we know we have a starting point. So we can either go forwards or we can go backwards. So in this case, we have a clue as towards what the epoch time is. We also have a clue that they set us a role of 101. And this is not out of a question. If you log into a website and you click on my account, it might say user role 101. But what I'm highlighting here is we have role 101, we have username Bobby, so we have some variables of this user that we know of that might be used to create that token. Yep, we get it. That's epoch time. Move on, buddy. So this is just my cheat sheet. So what I'm doing here is these are the syntaxes for the command. I just pasted the epoch time that was leaked from the server. Based on how we got different tokens when we were submitting multiple requests, I'm going to say that if the token is time-based or influenced by time, it's most likely going to be by milliseconds, because if it was by seconds, we would see a lot more collisions, because we can send 10 requests in a second, no problem. So what I'm doing here is adding 3 zeros and just saying, start from this time and do milliseconds. So do 999 versions of this number. And what I'm highlighting here is the tool that I've built that still needs work, but going to be released. You can do this in time units. So in this case, we're using milliseconds. You can also do seconds, hours, minutes, whatever you want, and then number of issues. So we're just generating a list of time values from this time just to make life easier. There's probably a kajillion ways of doing this. You could do this in a bash script. I just happen to write into a program so I can rinse and repeat. So clear. Oh. No, don't tell me what to do. I'll do what I want. Thank you. So let's see. What do you do? What do you do? I didn't even see what he did. Let's see. Generate. So what that command just did was just dump 100,000 epoch values, iterating upwards by 1 millisecond into a file, and then we're going to take that file, and we could take that file and just submit it. We can just hash that. Maybe the developer was super lazy and just hashed epoch time. Start simple. So let's just throw that against the wall. See if that sticks. But if that's not the case, then we have extra data. So let's see. So just go back. Go here. 10 minutes. So if it's not the case that it's just epoch time, the other portion here is we can add variables. So we know the username is Bobby. Maybe we know the user ID. We know the role ID. So we can throw that in and permutate that. So we'll put epoch time in the front, we'll put the username in the back, and we'll give every permutation in between. We're creating test candidates because we're trying to guess how the developer put this data together. And then we can also put a delimiter like a pipe or a comma. So all this tool does is basically permutate the various options. So there's a tool called Crunch that I was trying to go down the road of doing this first because that creates word lists from permutating data. I couldn't get it to do the delimiter and stuff, but that doesn't mean the tool doesn't do it. It just means I don't read documentation that well. So if anyone knows how to do this with Crunch, please let me know, because I'd rather not reinvent the wheel and use Crunch, which is a really good tool. So if you know that, please come talk to me. So what this is about to do is create permutations of that value with Bobby interjected into it. And we dumped the wrong thing. Flailing. Go faster. Show it. Type faster. Okay. All right. So what that command does is basically it generates all the epoch values, and then it appends Bobby to the front or backwards. And if there's three values, it would do that. And if there's delimiters, it would do that as well. So to speed things up, this is that same thing with the epoch time, pipe, Bobby, 101, and then every permutation of that. So we're just creating test candidates. And what we're doing with that is we're going to hash it with the algorithm that we're going to obfuscate it with the algorithm that we determined was what the developer was using. And we have options. We can test the tokens that we captured previously. And that's way faster. So instead of sending multiple requests to the web server, let's grab the 20,000 requests that we grabbed and the 20,000 requests that we did and just do a comparison. We can do that way faster. We can put a lot of horsepower behind that without using the latency of the server. Boom. Let's see. Okay, we'll run through this real quick. So determining other data elements. So this is still experimental because I wasn't able to implement this yet. But if our stupid simple way did not work and we still want more pain, we can try to figure out what the other data elements are. And the way we do this is we have our control group, which is the first set of requests we sent that we were able to produce the same token twice. Then we want to create an experimental group. And that experimental group is that control group modified by a variable. So if we logged in as Bobby, maybe we can log in as Jake and see if that has influence over it. And basically, we're going to do this for as many variables as we can, like the IP address. We test from one IP address, we'll use a proxy, test from another IP address, and then compare results. Because I'm short on time, we're going to kind of run through this. But example variables to test, anything that we can. User ID, email address, anything that might have influence with that number. Again, cut your losses is always an option. So things can get complicated. There might be data that we can't figure out, but there is a way that we can start systematically identifying data that might be there. So Observations. If the tokens produced within the same group do not collide with each other, our control scenario is unreliable. So if we replay what gave us the two identifiable tokens, doesn't do that again, we need to send more requests, more threads, or something changed. So we need to go back to step one. Tokens produced by the control group collide with tokens produced by the experimental group. We sent one thread of control, or two threads of control, two threads of experimental, and they collided. The two groups have collisions in between them. That means that the variable that we tested likely doesn't have influence over it, because we generate the same token even with that variable change. If we produce tokens and they do not, tokens produced by the experimental group do collide with tokens produced by the control group, do not collide, that they're likely that it influenced it. All experimental, theoretical at this point, because we didn't implement the code. Hopefully in a couple, we'll see if that changes. So I just want to touch on prevention really quick. So to avoid this from happening, recommendation, leverage existing frameworks. Stop reinventing the wheel. We have wheels. They're really good. People looked at them. So, you know, stop trying to do this on your own. But if you insist, or if you have to, or if there's some weird thing that you're doing, or you are creating the frameworks and standards, then you do need this advice. So when we're creating identifiers, we need to use cryptographically random source. We want to ensure a minimum amount of entropy, so it's hard to brute force, so 128 bits or more. The source content should be meaningless. It should not have any meaning. And we need to expire identifiers. So this makes it difficult. If we expire identifiers, then it makes the time that it takes to guess them less, more difficult. Stateless tokens, I recommend using JSON Web Token, JWT. So this is, if you're trying to do stateless applications, this is great. PayPal has released a framework for CSERF protection with JWT. Check that out. And there's various ways of protecting JWT. So signing them cryptographically, always verify the signature, and don't use the NUN algorithm. There was more research done where you can literally forge the JWT token by saying the algorithm equals NUN. And that basically says, don't verify the signature. I didn't sign it. So don't do that. Or don't trust that when someone says it. Don't put sensitive data in the tokens. Prevent replay, leverage an identifier. Same advice for the stateful tokens. And then time box. So if we time box these things, it makes things more difficult. Okay, any time for questions? 2 minutes? Questions? Sorry, I blew through the end. Go for it. I have not. The question was, have I used the timestamp value in TCP to get the clock? I have not, but that seems viable. I have talked to my network friends, but yeah, that definitely sounds like a good avenue to get like a time leak. So yeah, any time leak from the server that we can leverage, it would be awesome. Thank you. Any other questions? Awesome. Thank you very much for coming to my talk.
And for those of you who are new here, you know, we're here videotaping all the tracks, and so we have all the DVDs right out here on a table. For the first time ever at Shmoocon, we're also offering the entire conference on flash drive. And so if you're interested in that, it's like 260 or 280. And come see me if you have a blank flash drive. We can start loading up. I already have Saturday, but we can start loading up Sunday and Friday. Thank you.